Of seekers of the supernatural. I'm your moderator, Tony Spera, along tonight with Ed Warren and Lorraine Warren. And tonight, I think we'll talk about ghosts, about haunted houses. No, not over in England or Scotland, like we sometimes talk about, but right here in our own backyard. We're going to talk about a haunting that took place in Waterbury, Connecticut. It just came in. It's a recent case. And it's fascinating, it's real, it's scary, and I think what we'll do is we'll start out with Lorraine, if we could. Lorraine, could you just fill us in how you learned about this case in Waterbury?
The case was brought to our attention over the phone, Tony. It didn't come through any email or anything. It came through a telephone conversation.
Mm-hmm.
The woman seemed to focus a great deal of it on her daughter, who had an experience. It really wasn't until after we went to the house that we were aware that this home in Waterbury, every member of the family was witnessing phenomena in it. And it all started when the one daughter was a young age, very young age, and she woke from a sound sleep. She has no idea what woke her up. She turned over. She knows she was not dreaming. She went into her parents' room after that, when she could see a dark figure in the doorway.
Mm-hmm.
It filled the doorway, she said. It looked very tall, it looked very thin, and it had long fingers, and it waved to her.
Mm-hmm.
She covered her head at first. She knew she did that. A lot of things that she did made her aware that she was not dreaming what she was seeing, and it lasted for a period of time.
Well, you know, a lot of people will say, she's only a child. She's imagining it.
Mm-hmm.
But where does imagination stop and end and clairvoyance start?
Mm-hmm.
Children up to the age of 12, we know, are very clairvoyant. They're clairaudient, they're clairvisual. But a lot of families, especially the parents, will dismiss it as simply imagination. They've been dreaming something that just doesn't hold water. These kids see these things and they experience them.
Let me ask you a question, though. You said we know that children up to the age of 12 are very clairvoyant. Why are they?
Well, they're uninhibited, for one thing.
That's right, uninhibited. They don't realize that they're not supposed to see these things or hear them. But on the other hand, Tony, we find that in daycare centers and where children gather a lot, that we can set up cameras and we actually get pictures of many spirits just floating around the room near these children. Why? Because they're trying to gain the energy that these kids have. They're trying to draw it from them because they need some kind of fuel. That fuel is the energy that these children have. And you've seen kids how they are jumping around, playing. You could never follow them like a small puppy. That's why the spirits hang around the children.
Is that why they say like poltergeist activity begins? Because of the energy from the child?
Oh yeah, usually a child, where poltergeist is concerned, Tony, it usually happens with a child about the age of puberty.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, this child was younger than that. But you watch, like guests or friends that we were with, we were their guests this weekend, and we were watching their twins, six-year-old twins. Man alive, the energy that those two little kids had, and they have a 22-week-old, a Mastiff? Mm-hmm. A Bull Mastiff puppy. The three of them, I mean, imagine the energy that those children and that puppy emanate. Well, that's what happens in the haunted house. That's where it started.
Mm-hmm. Now, how long ago did this start?
Started 6 years ago.
Okay.
But it didn't really escalate to the point that it is at right now until a matter of just weeks ago. Then it
began.
That's
when you got the phone call.
That's when we got the phone call. That's when we went to the house.
Okay, so exactly what else happened besides?
Okay, now they believed that the spirit of a deceased relative plays a very important role. I could see that deceased relative in the house, but that deceased relative isn't causing a haunting. There's a difference between a spirit that is there in a protective way and a spirit that is there to cause disturbances. Something is there that is really causing disturbances. Now, the land who knows what was on that land.
Well, we did get some pictures back.
Oh, yes.
And it shows what looks like the top of a building or another foundation that's around the house. That tells us that maybe there was a barn there, maybe an old farmhouse that they've long since forgotten about. Because we've been on cases 30 and 40 years ago, the houses have been knocked down, the foliage has grown up. You'd never suspect a house ever being there. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't have some old neighbor around to say, well, yeah, there used to be an old farmhouse there, nobody would ever know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I think that's what's happened here. There was a building right where that house is standing today, and something happened there, tragedy or rituals, something that has brought these spirits in.
But
and what the girl is describing is not Casper the Ghost.
Oh, no, no, no.
What is she exactly describing?
She's describing this dark figure. Now, we now have evidence, Tony, of shadow ghosts in this building actually moving right in certain areas. We get this fluttering noise. And one of the really amazing things is that one of the researchers getting evidence in the house through the night had a little container of Tic Tacs.
Mm-hmm.
That seemed to activate something. You never know what is going to activate. And just the
sound of it seemed
well,
a lot of times I'll rap on a wall.
And
just
that was
to see if I get a rap back. This could be the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Now, after the first time that we were there, this is just the first time Ed and I had gone in to do an interview in the building. Then things began to escalate. They have carpet on the stairways, and there's a back porch that's covered. They will hear the seats go down. They will hear the springs in the furniture on the porch.
Now, we have to explain something here. How do they hear the cushions go down with the springs in them? Nobody's sitting there.
Mm-mm.
It comes through a phenomenon called telekinesis, which means telepathic sound. If I were the ghost and I wanted you to hear that, I would simply think of what it sounds like when somebody sits on that chair and the springs go down, and I would project that to the person I want to project it to, who is what we call clairaudient.
Okay, so in other words, that ghost is not really sitting in that chair?
No. Sometimes they do.
Sometimes they are, but they can project that kind of a noise, Tony. Now, there on these stairs, they would hear somebody walking up and down these stairs. But Tony, they hear somebody walking up and down on wood stairs. That is the amazing thing. There are no wood stairs. That everything is carpeted. But that's how it'll appear. Then the pounding started. The pounding started right after we were there. Now the reason for that is, as soon as we would go in to the house, where we posed a threat to whatever is there in getting rid of it, then it's going to become activated. And with our leaving there, not the first night, it didn't happen, but it happened the second night.
Mm-hmm.
And the second night, they began to get the poundings.
Now, I have to explain that. When we go into a house, as you know, Tony, even though things are happening, they might subside for a few hours, but then all hell breaks loose.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's what happened in this house.
Yes. So we won't have it right away, Tony, because actually we're compiling everything. We were excited about the case and felt that it definitely warranted sharing.
Oh, we had two different teams in there.
Yes.
First, one night, the team stayed all night. They had all kinds of equipment set up, scientific equipment to monitor the drafts in the house, the sounds, anything going through the room, taking photographs, still photographs, taking video, and we did get a lot of evidence in that house.
Yes, we have a great deal of evidence in the house. Now, we have globules, Tony, and globules show spirits.
Mm-hmm.
There's more than one spirit, and in certain areas of these houses, even a new researcher going in on the case got what he described as a globule in one bedroom that has to measure a foot across.
Let me ask you guys a question. That's just an objective party. Why do you think these things are happening in the house in the first place?
Well, I think that my feeling, Tony, whether it's psychic or otherwise, my feeling is that there may be a graveyard here, because where there was old property, Tony, and where there may be farm hands and like that, people didn't get buried in cemeteries. They were just buried right on the land. And because in this particular case, in this particular home, they are seen outside the house as well as inside the house. There has been three different figures that have been spotted outside of this house. In the yard, in the back, the mother had felt the presence of someone behind her. Daylight, she knew someone was behind her. She looked, but she couldn't see anybody. But she says it was an overwhelming feeling of something.
Where was the little girl saying?
On the street.
Now, she was dressed.
In period dress.
Yeah, in period dress.
In period dress.
Old, like
in
what?
Old-fashioned dress.
Probably, more like the turn of the century, Tone, about that far back. And then another time, she was walking up the driveway. They were going out to take their two dogs for a walk. Mm-hmm. And as they were going up the driveway, there's a man standing right at the top of the driveway. They
that
could
was
see
in daytime.
Yes,
daytime.
It's dusk. It's only dusk. It's not dark out. And they could look and see the color of this man's clothing and all that he was wearing. Parts of the plaid, parts of it, they could see, parts of the plaid.
Now, who lives in that house exactly? Who are the people? Are they a man, a woman, or?
A man and woman, three children, and a visiting grandmother.
Okay, and you said the phenomenon started about 6 years ago?
6 years ago with the one daughter.
Okay.
With one daughter. All started with her.
Why do you think it's escalating, though?
I don't know why it's escalating, Tony. None of these people in this house are using any type of occult practice. There is positively no drugs, no alcohol used in this home.
Unlike our house.
Didn't they do some repairs just recently?
They did some repairs. Yes,
repairs in a home, changing doorways. Even a simple thing as a doorway will start this type of phenomenon.
Why is that it?
Because your spirit, you've been going through that doorway all of your life. Then during the transition of going into the spirit world, you're still going through that doorway for maybe 10, 15 years. All of a sudden, it's not there. This is upsetting, disturbing to the spirit. And sometimes it'll start to cause disturbances.
Do you think what's there is an earthbound spirit, perhaps?
No.
More than one.
No. But
you think it's earthbound, or you think it's something
I don't know.
Spirit?
That's very hard, Tony.
Maybe you should tell the audience that what an earthbound spirit versus what you think might be there.
The earthbound spirit, of course, is a person that dies and remains on for different reasons. It could be that they feel they have to stay there because their family needs them. It could be that they've died very quickly. They don't even realize they're dead, and they're very disturbed. It's similar to a person who has been heavily sedated or drugged. They're not really with it. And then, of course, there's the person who says, this is my house, I'm not leaving it, nobody's going to move into it. But in this case, it wouldn't be that way because these people had lived there for years already.
Mm-hmm.
Now, who owned that house?
Well, let me tell you, the people that, that's what I was going to say, the people that owned the house before this family moved in, they're there a number of years. But the people who owned it before were the people who finished off that basement, put the two bedrooms down there and this large rec room. And their children would not sleep down there.
Well, that tells you something right there.
So they had bad vibes down
because
there?
Because there was bad. There is bad vibes down there, Tony.
Did you feel it, too, Ed? I know you're not psychic like Lorraine, but did you feel anything in the house?
I didn't feel it, Tony.
No,
he didn't. He doesn't feel it that much. But the I know.
See it, hear it, touch it.
I know the one relative, Tony, the one relative that is in the house, I don't believe that spirit is earthbound. I think that person has accepted their death, but does come back from time to time. Because it is his relative that's there, the grandmother.
When did the grandmother move in?
Not that long. She's only there for the summer. She's
right.
only there
a
for
a lot
the
of things escalated when she came in.
Yeah, in her part. Now, this is the amazing thing. After the first group was there, after we had an all-night group stay in the house.
An investigative team.
The investigative team, spending the whole night there. The following night, when the father came home from work, he called me and said, "Do you want me to leave everything all thrown around where they left it all thrown around downstairs?" And I said,
"Our team doesn't do that."
I says, "I don't think anybody on our team would leave stuff thrown around." And so I checked with them. Nobody left anything. So everything was all thrown around downstairs in that one room. Laundry that was folded and other things that were there. So that shows that the spirit was very, very angry. But we're still getting evidence. So.
This is in a very wooded area. The house is surrounded by trees, by foliage. So you have a natural fuel here for a lot of the spirits outside. They can draw the electromagnetic energy from the plant life and manifest themselves, or they can project an image telepathically. But I think in this case, they're actually manifesting from the shrubbery and the forest around it.
So what's your plan now? Say you go to the house, right?
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, you investigate the house, you gather evidence, you have your teams in there. At this point, now what's your next move? What are you going to do now?
Well, first we have to document. We have to know exactly what we're dealing with, Tony.
Is it human or is it inhuman?
That's very hard right now. Is
you
it
don't
a
know
very.
For sure.
No, is
because,
it a very.
Because an evil spirit can look like anybody. They can look like you, me, Lorraine, anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Just by thinking of what they want to look like and projecting that image to the viewer. So we have to make sure that we're not dealing with something inhuman as versus the human spirit. Because the human spirit, we can get rid of very easily. But the inhuman, that's another thing.
But now, in this case, Tony, the globules that we see, mm-hmm. we know that that is all spirit energy, that is what comprises the ghost. We have a lot of that. They're ghosts, Tony.
Now what advice do you give the family when you're like, you're not there?
Well, we talk to them a lot.
Yeah, this happens to be a Catholic family. And I told them, I said, now when you experience something, for instance, you see the ghost over there, just make the sign of the cross very large with your right hand, command it in the name of Jesus Christ to leave and go back to where it came from. Now, if it's inhuman, it's not going to leave. If it's human, there's a chance that it will. Because a human being who has been a very religious person will still obey the laws of the church.
Now, one thing that happened, see, there's so many confusing things in this home, Tony. That's why we have to wait till we have all our evidence. For instance, the daughter woke up one night. And no, I'll take that back. She did wake up. She woke up because she was cold. Because she is not sleeping in her room. She was sleeping in another room of the house.
Mm-hmm.
And she went into her parents' bedroom to get an extra quilt to put over her. When she walked in the bedroom at 11 o'clock at night, there was a dark figure looking over the mother in bed.
Now that's a shadow ghost.
That
dark figure, what's that represent?
That represents evil or negative. Now, that is what we also have on film. Now, very seldom do you
no,
get...
No, you say film. Do you mean...
Video.
Video. Tape.
On videotape.
Okay.
We have that on video. We already have that on video. We only know what is reported. You can't look hours at that, hours upon hours upon hours of all of this video. So each researcher goes through his, he knows what he has to look for,
right.
And then he brings that evidence to us.
Let's take two scenarios if we could. Let's say it's a human spirit.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do?
Then you can have a house blessing, Tony, and you can get rid of it.
By what? Calling in a priest?
Calling in a clergy, and you can get rid of it. It's a blessing. You're asking.
Will that get rid of the spirit?
The human spirit. Do they want to get rid of the human spirit? The human spirit has been there a very long time. The human spirit is a relative that they actually like. They know when he's around. And it's the movement of very small things. Very, very small things. It's almost like he's letting them know about his presence. Opening the jar, a cookie jar, and moving the glass top on it.
All
moving cigarettes.
All right, let's just say it's it's not a human spirit. It's a bad spirit. It's an evil spirit. What do you do?
Then it's an exorcism type of thing.
We'll have to have what we call self-immunication performed by a very knowledgeable person. This means they have to go into that house, the family has to leave, they have to saturate it with high church incense, it has to be blessed by a very pious priest, and the ritual prayers will be said at the same time. If it's done properly, 9 out of 10 times it'll be successful.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we'll call for then. But first we'll go through the laws of the church. If it's a Catholic family, we depend on Catholic priests to do mm-hmm. it. Protestant, happens to be bishop or Baptist, then we'll depend on a Baptist minister.
Now, then you're saying then it's a haunted house, not a haunted person.
It's a haunted house.
It's not a haunted person, Tony.
It seems to generate mostly from the girls' room.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're going to do, in fact, that's tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be setting up cameras all around her room and in the room to see what we can pick up.
But when Ed's talking about clergy going in, it isn't just a clergyman going in, Tony. That man has to be very knowledgeable in the areas of demonology. That man has to have a firm belief in the fact that mm-hmm. The personification
at this
of evil
point, though,
can
manifest. What would your gut instinct tell you that is in the house?
Inhuman.
Inhuman?
Yeah. The
big question I have is, what would draw something like that inhuman spirit to a house like that?
A tragedy, Tony. A tragedy that had occurred on these grounds long before.
Like a murder or something like that?
A murder could have happened, yes, and a person buried there.
Could nothing have happened and then still an evil spirit shows up?
That'd be very hard. How is
that? I don't know. I'm just wondering.
See,
well,
we have
in
no
one sense it would be hard, but understand this, that evil spirits are all over. They're just waiting for the opportunity for somebody to open up a door so it can come in. You can come in through a seance.
But you don't see it.
You can come in through a Ouija board. You can come in through fooling with rituals of voodoo or Santeria. Anything like that will bring in evil spirits.
But you don't see that. You don't see any evidence of that. You see a very disciplined household.
Oh, yeah. Now could
loving household.
Is it possible that somebody could have put a curse on those people and brought a spirit, made a spirit go away?
Anything is possible
it's
in
possible.
The worlds that we work in, Tony.
Yes.
That's why it takes more film, more evidence to really find out what we got here and what we have to do.
Now, nothing has been said like that, Tony. We don't know anything about relatives like that. You just don't get that type of impression. These people have lived other places other than this country.
Mm-hmm.
They have lived in other countries.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And remember, we've only been working on the case a week, and all of a sudden you'll find out things that you never knew existed before.
Once you
said, well, now there was the time that I did this or I did that or something happened.
Yes.
But they're not coming clean with everything that's happened so far.
We see that an awful lot, Tony.
You know, it's like when you go to confession, Tony. You never told all your sins, did you? Neither did I. But that's what it's
that's
like.
Nice.
These people aren't going to tell all their sins, you know.
That's
not right off the bat.
And you're asking Tony that?
Yes.
Confession? I have no sins to confess.
Well, that's...
But I forgot you were immaculate.
That's
I forgot.
Right.
Sorry.
All right, so on a scale of, say, 1 to 10, 1 being the lowest kind of a haunting, 10 being the worst you've ever seen.
I want to see what it's going to say. I know what I'm going to say.
I'd say it's about a 4.
I'd
so it's
say
not totally crazy, out of control.
No, and I
but
would
it's also
give it,
not the. Not
I would give it more of a 6.5.
More like a moderate.
I'm on the.
How many times I told you?
Never correct
I
you.
I said it's a 4.5. It's a 4.5.
But the reason, Tony, is that I'm on the phone a great deal with each and every one of these researchers who are spending.
Well, Ed's out. Well, Ed's out jogging.
Ed's out jogging.
Well, let me ask you this.
Getting all of their insights.
Let's put it in perspective for the viewers then. You say it's a 4. You say it's probably a 5 or a 6. What was Amityville?
Ooh. That was a 20 on a scale of 1 to 20.
Seriously? Was Amityville a 20?
Yeah. Amityville was one of the worst cases we were ever involved with. Not because of so much of what happened when we were there, which a lot of things did, but what followed us home, what followed us all over the country. Any place we'd go, we'd mention Amityville and start thinking about things that happened. Things would happen.
Well, then I got news for you. This afternoon, I got a phone call from one of the researchers who went there first, and he said, do you think this house is negative? I says, we haven't decided that yet. I said, why? Why are you asking me? He said, because a lot of crazy stuff is happening in my life. I said, since when? He said, since I went in the house. See, that is one thing.
That's kind of a common occurrence, isn't
it? Yes,
it
is. Yes, it is. That's why when people say, oh, I'd love to go into a haunted house with you, you know, like a young man in Stop and Shop. I think the world of this kid. He's such a nice kid. Good-looking boy, smart, bright kid. He says, Mrs. Warren, do you think I could just carry equipment for you in the house? How could you ever?
That's what he might carry out of there.
Yeah, how could you?
Something can follow him out, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
Something that could be attracted to him.
What's the worst case in Connecticut as far as a haunted house goes?
Lindley Street.
Was it Lindley, Ed, or was it maybe Brookfield?
I'd say Brookfield, Lindley Street were about on the same
and level. And West Hartford.
And don't forget the Maurice Thurial case.
Oh, yeah, well, no, Connecticut. He says Connecticut.
I just wonder.
There's so many.
There's so many, but...
You know, when you're sitting in a house and you see things rise up and smash and break and fire start right before your eyes, that's heavy stuff.
Well, yeah, should you guys ever get scared in there?
Yeah.
Well, always do.
Well, in houses like that, Tony, I have found myself breaking down and crying. I think I cry out of frustration. You know, I don't know if I'm crying out of fear. It just gets so frustrating to you to see this much damage.
Excuse me, sorry for interrupting, but what would you say to the skeptics out there, Ed, and I'm sure there's some skeptics watching this show, maybe a husband of a woman who believes in ghosts and the husband doesn't. What would you say to the skeptics who say, that is just a bunch of baloney? What would you say?
Well, try to keep an open mind. Remember that there are things that scientists today, ourselves, just don't understand. We can't explain it, but keep an open mind because you can tell your wife what type of person she is. Does she imagine a lot of the things occurring? Is she sensitive? If she continually complains about seeing a ghost or things happening, you have to give this woman the benefit of the doubt.
Mm.
I mean, why wouldn't you? She's your wife, you love her. Why not give her the benefit of the doubt?
Like my wife in the morning when she wakes up, she goes, I thought I was with Tom Selleck last night. She was. She was with me.
Sure she was, Tom. Sure
she wasn't really dreaming. What would you say to the skeptics, Lorraine?
I would say look at the evidence. Look at the amount of evidence today that we didn't have years ago. Years ago, we didn't have this kind of evidence, Tony. We didn't have the ability to gain video footage of what goes on in these homes. Sure, we'd have still photographs, and they could poke every kind of a hole in the world.
In your heart of hearts, it's real. In your heart of hearts, that it's real. We're just about out of time. So, Lorraine, if you'd like to give out our P.O. box for communication with us, why don't you do that?
Post Office Box 41, Monroe, Connecticut, 06468. And we'd love to hear. I love reading your letters.
Yep, you can write to the Warrens at that address. And we are out of time right now, I'm being told, by Vinny, our cameraman on camera one. For Ed Warren, for Lorraine Warren, for Charter Communications, I'm Tony Sparrow. Have a good night.